my love. There's so many ways I want to say I love you. Let me hold you in my arms forevermore.
John Cabrera, we meet again.
Yeah.
For any of you wondering why I played that cheesy music as we entered into this episode, that was because that was the number one song in November 1980. That could have been what Craig Miller was listening to as he and Mary Elizabeth Sowers rode up to the carousel at the Arden Fair Mall on that cold Sacramento night for a night of fraternity party at the for Founders Day. And their life was changed. Their life was ended. And we're going to get into that. But I just want to set the tone that that was the number one song when that happened. If there's anything to be cut to come out of that, it is that at least their deaths led to the capture of two of the actually most heinous murderers. I got to tell you, John, I do a lot of this and I've done a number with you. By the way, you're incredibly popular, but I've done a number with you. None of them have affected me like this murder, like this couple. Dorothea Puente, yes, Dorothea Puente was a sociopath and she was a grifter and her grift game got higher and higher until it led to what it led to, right? And got it. Comiskey. Same thing. She was a really smart woman, started on the wrong track, kept going down the wrong track, was a track star on that wrong track, led to murder. She was caught. And all of the true crime stories that I read about or watch, none have affected me like this one. The story of Charlene and Gerald Gallego, the sex slave murderers. Yeah, none have. I got to be honest with you. Reading the cases, and I've read court documents. I've done, you know, background, read a couple of books. None of the other cases have affected me like this. And the way that the victims were treated and tortured and killed and had their minds played with, and the innocence that Gerald and, in my mind, Charlene took from these people because of the age and the time that we lived in. It's kind of funny, not funny, but it's kind of interesting that if you look at these cases, it's almost like an absolute snapshot into the 1970s. You got the Chevy van, right, with a nature shot on the side of it. You got the, hey, you want to go get high in the back of my van? You got that. Right. You got the little sorority fraternity dance at the carousel, you know, which is in the suburbs and, you know, a total 1970s thing to do. You got them telling their parents we're not coming over because we're going to be playing pinball. It just is a real snapshot into the 1970s. The victims, young women just walking around free, not even worried, not like today. You know, that wouldn't happen today. Today, those kids would not be walking around like they were, I think, some of these victims in the late 1970s and early 1980s. It's a snapshot into a time which I think we've left and which I think people like Charlene and Gerald made us aware that, hey, maybe we need to buckle down. Maybe we need to be a little more safe. So anyway, I want to make sure that I let off with that this was a very, very hard case for me to dig into simply because of the nature of the crimes. It was tough for me, but you were there. You were there. Right. What were you doing when this started to unfold?
Well, I was just transferring from the vice unit to the homicide unit in 1980.
Okay.
And I wasn't aware of the crimes that had been taking place in 1978 up to that point. When I got to the unit, I was very much aware of Craig Miller and Mary's disappearance, and then him being found first dead. And so coming from Vice, it was very much of interest to me because I worked with a lot of seedy people. When you're working Vice, you know, you work the underworld. And plus you work a lot of bars and you check licenses and you check their patronage and who's going on. But you also check a lot of other areas in which is dealing with nothing but the underworld of Sacramento. And so I was very interested in that case. And then fortunately, my good colleague, Detective Jean Burchette, had asked me to assist him on a couple of things. And, you know, for me, that was, I was really, really excited about being involved in it and getting a look at what really happened.
Yeah. Because when that case happened, this is, and this is the final case, we're jumping ahead here, but there's a reason why we're jumping ahead. The murder of Craig Miller and Mary Elizabeth Sowers, they were like the all-American couple. And I know we use that a lot, but if you read the stories, they were honestly the all-American couple, especially for 1980 California,
And they had so much ahead of them. You know, there was so much ahead of each of them career-wise. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they were the perfect couple, young couple, Sac State students, and they had it all.
They had it all.
And they were just going to have a good time and just continue to move on into those great directions, which they were heading to. And it was just very, very sad.
And it really captured the Sacramento region and I think the North State at large. When that murder happened, it was at a very popular mall. The Arden Fair Mall in Sacramento at that time was a very, very popular mall. That was a very growing part of Sacramento. Those suburbs are a little dated now, but they were new then. And the Arden Fair was a fresh, exciting mall. And that's where they were picked up. So let's go back to the beginning. Gerald Gallego, his father, Gerald Gallego Sr., is famous. He had a famous dad. His dad was the first convicted man to be executed in the Mississippi gas chamber. He was a two-time murderer with a long, long line of crimes behind him. And he one of the things he left us was his son, Gerald Gallego Jr. His mother was a sex worker. Was that right?
Well, yeah, sex worker, or we would call prostitute.
Mm-hmm. And how did Gerald grow up, Junior?
Well, you know, Gerald, his life, I mean, I can say that it wasn't the best of all. I mean, his father was a criminal. His father was basically estranged. So he really had no contact with his father. His father was always in crimes, and then he was in prison. Mm-hmm. And his mother was a prostitute. Men coming over the house all the time. He had to live with that. Probably some abuse going on there. And that's what he grew up with. I mean, that's the atmosphere he grew up with.
Was that in Chico? Or where did he grow up?
He was born in Sacramento.
Okay. Do we know what part? Do you know?
No.
Okay. I've always wondered. I didn't see it anywhere.
Yeah.
Either.
No. He was born in Sacramento.
Okay.
And so, you know, his life growing up in the early stages was really a tough life for any kid, you know. But apparently there was something that affected him. Or whatever it was. But again, you have to look at his father. His father was a stone cold criminal.
Yep.
And of course, as you said, he was one of the first people executed in Mississippi in 1955. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, what you have to look at is, you know, what did he leave? Was it a bad seed? Or was it everything else that Gerald had been involved in and going through as a young person, which started him on this trail of perversion, you know, and murder?
Yeah. I think his first brushes with the law were when he was six. He started getting in trouble with the law. I mean, you know what, man? That takes a lot of effort. That takes a lot of effort to be a six-year-old and already having brushes with the law, right? I mean, it's not easy.
No.
You got to plan that shit out.
Yeah.
And then I know his first incarceration, I think, was when he was 13.
Right.
And he had been, you know, sexually abusing young girls, like very, very young, like six-year-old,
yeah.
Yeah.
In fact, it was a six-year-old that he was abusing and which he was arrested for. Mm-hmm. That was his first time that he would be incarcerated, you know, and It's just amazing, you know, at that age, to be able to put something together like that, think it out, and then act it out, and do it. But he was already doing things.
Yeah. So after 13 and through his whole adulthood, was it just a constant parade of arrests, incarceration, arrests, and marriages? Because by the time he married Charlene Williams, who later became Sharon Gallego, he had already been married five times, right? I think throughout the 60s, he had already been married maybe five or maybe four. And then he might have had one after the early 70s. But what do you know about that?
I think it was a total of seven times that he was married.
And twice to the same woman.
Twice to the same woman.
Yes.
So it would have been six people, but it was seven marriages. And it was just one after the other. Mm-hmm. And so, which is one of the things that would help bring him down also, that we can talk about later.
As we get there.
Is his alleged marriages.
So he was in and out of prison, literally prison. He went to prison with his brother, right?
Right.
Showing you the apple doesn't fall far from that daddy tree. And they were caught with an armed robbery of a motel in Vacaville, which is down the freeway from Sacramento, about, 35, 40 minutes, depending how the traffic is. And they were caught there and then they were sent to prison, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Sentenced to prison. And he did a little over 3 years when he gets paroled out.
You know what's interesting, John, is the more I, get into these types of cases, what I have found, even in the case of the Batgirl, even in the case of, especially the case of Dorothea Puente, when you finally hear about these people in only the, and I haven't really seen the case, but I will, just for the sake of argument, in only the very, 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 very rarest of cases, is this like a first or second time. Almost always there is, like Dorothea Puente, a lifetime of grifting and ripping off and multiple marriages and ripping off husbands and just a lifetime of scammery, right? And same with Comiskey. She was very young, but man, she burned hot. Same thing, going through men, always had a scam, always had a play. And the same thing with Gerald Gallego. Yes, he was caught on these murders, right? Because I think eventually their arc gets so high, it has to fall. But it was a lifetime of crime for this guy before he teamed up with Charlene.
Yeah. And, when we look back at these types of individuals that are involved in these horrific crimes, a lot of them start out and it's what we call nickel and dime crimes, but it starts very early, and it's this and it's a hand slap and it's juvenile hall. And it's a lot of theft, burglary, grand theft auto, things like that, in which Gerald was involved in. And then it just seems to escalate. It's like they spawn into a whole new genre, mm-hmm. and what they were doing and how they deviate from what they were doing before. And now it's really becoming serious crimes. Just like, Dorothea Puente started with, a few grifting things here and there. And then it just progressed to where she just figured, hey, just put these people to death and I don't have to worry about ever getting caught. Because she got tired of getting caught. Just like Gerald. Right.
So in the 60s, I think it was in 64, during the midst of all of these marriages that he had. And by the way, they all ended kind of in the same way. He spent all their money and beat them. And finally, they left him. I think one only lasted a month. But it was the same pattern. He would marry these women. Often they had very little. A couple of were laundresses, which was a job, during that period, when not everybody had a washing and dryer, in their home. And he would eventually, just abuse them, beat them, philander, and take all their money, spend all their money, and then they would leave him or he would just move on to the next one.
Right? I mean, he was married, but, he was a philanderer. He had girlfriends, mistresses. That was just part of his whole thing. Mm-hmm. He was going through wives like, you would go through water while walking through the desert.
Yeah.
And it was just amazing.
So you saw the guy, right? You met the guy.
Yeah, I did.
What attracted these women to this guy?
The first time I saw him, we brought him over, Detective Burchette and myself. We brought him over from the old Sacramento County Jail, chained up because of what he was in for. And we brought him over to the Hall of Justice and put him in the homicide room. And I was just caught off by his size, because I
big
thought-
Big guy?
Husky, but short.
Really?
Real short.
Really?
I mean, I had this idea. It was like, is he 5'7", 5'8"? So we wanted to make sure he was shackled up good enough. And going over there and bringing him back, and I saw this guy that maybe was 5'5 at best, muscular, chiseled face.
Really?
Dark eyes. Oh, yeah. He just, I was taken back. And, he had these eyes. I'll never forget. He had these dark eyes. It reminded me of Charles Manson. And they were just piercing. He'd just look at you as you're talking to him. And then he just had these dark eyes. And it was amazing. I mean, it was something else. But I was taken back by his size.
You expected bigger. I mean, the way he overpowered people, right?
The way he, overpowered people, the way he carried on wherever he worked in bars and other places, you'd think here's a guy that was so self-assured, about himself.
Correct.
Yeah, he was, you know, I'm muscular, nobody messed with him, and nobody bothered him. And I thought, and then I see this and I think, oh my gosh. But that was his persona.
Yeah.
I mean, he put off this persona, like, and he was very good at it. You know, it was like, he could look right through you, like, you're nobody to me, you know? And I think a lot of people thought if he said something to them, they'd kind of like, move, wait a minute. You know, because he had a somewhat of a build, and he had this real chiseled face, and you kind of go like, wow, you know, and he had that look.
Did he talk to you?
No, Gene, I think Gene had in mind some things that he wanted to briefly ask him, but he wasn't about to say anything. He's, hey, for him, it was just an out being out. And so we took him back. We weren't out that long. We took him back. But I think one of the things that amazed me the most, taking him back, we entered into the back of the jail where they also take the females in and the males, and then they divide them up. And I was taken back as they hooked him up because there was some other prisoners in there. So they were going to all put them all back. So he just joined the rest of the line. But right in the room next door was where the female deputies were and where you booked your female prisoners. And there was a tall female deputy there. And I'm standing behind the group of guys waiting for them to move so we can leave. But we want the guys to go out. We don't want to open the doors, of course. And so I'm looking at him and he starts jumping up and down. Literally jumping up and down over these guys because he's so short. But he was trying to get a look at the female deputy, the blonde.
Like he just couldn't help himself.
He could not help himself. And, you know, I'm looking at Gene and I'm like to myself, I'm thinking, my gosh, this guy, all the stuff that he's done, it's not enough. He's got to see that blonde female deputy. And he keeps bouncing up and down until the deputy sheriff in there tells him, hey, settle down. And I was just like, this guy is nuts. This guy, even in this type of situation, he still has to get a glance at this female deputy.
You know, it's interesting. That story is very interesting because it kind of goes along with who we're going to talk about next, Charlene. Because Charlene, in some of the court papers that I read, she described him as once his train started rolling, it couldn't stop.
Right.
Once that drive in him to go get someone, she said there was no stopping it. You could not stop. Well, and of course, my opinion on her, you know, will be known. But anyway, it's funny that that's a personality trait that she gave.
Yeah, it was remarkable.
Yeah.
I'll never forget it. And I just thinking about that, and I thought it wasn't enough.
God, thank God that guy was behind bars.
Oh, yeah.
Charlene Williams. So Charlene Williams, later to be known as Charlene Gallego. Charlene Williams was born in Sacramento to, I think, an upper middle class family. Her father was an executive at, it said, I keep seeing supermarket chain. I'm assuming Raley's. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know either. But yeah. She was born in Stockton.
Oh, she was born in
Stockton.
Actually,
she was born in Stockton.
That's right.
And her father was an executive, held a high position. Mm-hmm. I mean, her family, she come from a good family.
Yeah.
You know, her mother, father, mm-hmm. she had just about everything I think she wanted, mm-hmm. you know, and
went to a great high school. She went to Rio Americana High School.
Yeah. I mean, you know, where they always say, oh, that's a school of the rich kids.
Yes.
But I mean, it sits there off American River Drive. Fantastic school.
Yeah.
You know, great curriculum. And people that lived in those areas of a high income level.
That's right.
All their children went there. You know,
and we're talking about in Sacramento, there's an area called Arden Park. And that is even to this day, actually today, it's probably even more so because some of the people who live there, probably when Charlene's family lived there, they've bought those houses and blown them out even bigger. But it's always been a place of executives and professionals.
Yes.
And Arden Park is where she grew up. And as you said, she went to Rio Americana, which is, I think, at least in the city of Sacramento, a scene where all the rich kids go. And that's where she went.
Yeah.
And the descriptions of her, she was very small, very petite.
Very.
Very petite.
Kind of mousy. You know, I think the term mousy would fit her.
And it's funny because when I see pictures of them, he's like towering over her. And as you said, he was short. And I don't know if he was wearing boots or something.
It's funny you say that because one of the things about him is he always portrayed himself to be taller in photographs. If you look at their photographs, he's always above her,
oh.
You know, which you see this dominance. He had to be the dominating person. And all the photographs, she's low and he's low. Yeah, he looks like he could be 6 feet.
Yes.
And she could be 5'8". You know? And so, but that's one of the things that he did. He made himself bigger, you know, than what he really was in life. He had to do that.
I noticed, well, thank you for clarifying that, because in a lot of the picture, because I knew that he was short based on conversations I had had with you. I didn't know how short, but I saw her standing next to him and I was like, holy cow, she must have been like 4'1".
Well, yeah, you'd think that.
You would think that, yeah. Right? But that was all planned by him.
Right.
As part of his scheme of dominance.
It's something he did. And if you look at all the photos, you'll never see anyone above him. He reigned. And in his mind, he reigned supreme.
Man. And he never really had a job in and out of prison. I don't know if he was street smart, but he definitely was not book smart.
No.
And I think that his intelligence is really questioned as we get to the end of their run, when you can see all the dumb mistakes he made. So it's kind of funny how someone like that would have to be the supreme guy.
Right.
That's crazy.
This is what he put off as far as his character. I mean, that he was a supreme person. I mean, he knew that Charlene was intelligent.
Mm-hmm.
She knew it.
Mm-hmm.
She knew she was smarter than him just by talking to him. And then later on, as you mentioned, by the things that he starts doing, she's thinking, what an idiot.
Yes, he was. He
what
did
an
some
idiot,
stupid
you know?
Shit.
And she kept those mm-hmm. thoughts to herself, mm-hmm. knowing that if she ever said anything like that, mm-hmm. that would be terrible.
So she was, by all descriptions that I've seen or read, you know, as you said, mousy, petite, quiet, and very, very intelligent. Everybody always called her very intelligent. Now, she met him when she was 23, I believe, right?
Right.
Well, she'd already been married and divorced twice.
Twice. Yes.
And she had, in the middle of all that, or after all that, she had had an affair with a military guy.
Right.
And from what I've read is that she was having the affair with the military guy, and he actually asked for the whole thing to get called off because she said, I want your wife to join us in a threesome. And he's like, no, hey, I didn't sign up for that shit.
Right.
So he ended it. So again, as we said earlier, right, when, you know, because people, oh, Charlene, poor victim. No, she was, you know, there was some stuff there before she even met.
And a little history on that, going back to high school. You know, in high school, she started out and she was, you know, good student. Everything was going good. But then she started experimenting with drugs. And a lot of issues issues were coming from that. She started experimenting in sex. Mm-hmm. And things just started getting bad. And it went from bad to worse. And so she was already starting doing dope and involving herself in all these situations. And and then finishing, you know, high school. She was only allowed to graduate from high school because she had she needed to get her points, and they allowed her to do that. Otherwise, probably anyone else, because of what she was failing in at the school, they would have booted her. But they kept her. She was allowed to stay to the school. And then she got out, but now she was already turning to be a different person.
Yes.
And even other people in school, you know, that I read, was they would refer to her as a slut. Because people started to see mm-hmm. about her background and what she was already doing.
Yeah. So, again, you know, we often, you'll hear the story told about the Gallegos, and it's like, oh, you know, this poor little mousy Charlene. And she had turned a corner somewhere in there, you probably led by the drugs and the people that she was hanging out with, you know, because it was a different world then. So I think her life turned. In fact, one of her husbands left her because he said, when I met her, she was quiet, she was shy, she would be at home. And suddenly she started going out, getting her hair done all fancy, wearing makeup and wanting to go out. And he's like, she's not the woman I married.
No. Her parents doted over her. I mean, in the beginning, you know, she was doted over by her parents. They took care of her. They got a lot. They got her the car. They got her all kinds of different things. And then she just started to get into those changes.
Mm-hmm.
So that was when the real problems began. And then, of course, it just kind of escalated. And even into community college, she did a quick burst in a local community college. That didn't last long. She quit because she didn't want to be a part of that.
So how'd these two meet? How did these two, I mean, as even though we're saying Charlene, you know, took a different turn and had changed personality wise and wasn't what people have portrayed her to be, she was no Gerald Gallego.
No.
No Gerald Gallego.
No, that she wasn't.
That guy was, yeah. So how did those two people get together?
Well, you know, she'd been married twice before. Mm-hmm. The first individual was a really nice guy. Really nice guy. But I think she just, for some reason, couldn't go along with that.
She didn't like the nice guy.
No, the nice guy. I mean, he had money. Things looked good, you know, but she decided she didn't like that. So then she marries the second guy. He turns out to be a drug addict. So she divorces him. Now she's single again. So a friend of hers keeps talking into going out on a blind date.
Oh, my God.
With this guy that worked at a card room.
We got to get the name of that friend, because that friend changed history.
Right.
From that one moment when he was having that drink and thought, hey, I got to get those two together.
Yeah.
And my God.
Yeah. Well, the person kept asking her, and then finally she accepted this blind date. And the blind date just happened to turn out to be Gerald Gallegos.
And do you know where they met?
I think they just went out. I'm not sure what exactly they did, but, you know, she wanted to get a feel for him. They might have gone to a show or something, but she wanted to kind of get a feel for him. But I think one of the things that struck her was his manliness.
Yeah, I read that too.
His manliness. Her father was very dominant in her life, and she looked up to her father. He was a strong individual. And she sees Gerald. Understandably, she sees that he's not all that tall, but his personality made him bigger than life in her eyes.
Wow.
And so she sees beyond, you know, his stature as far as how tall he is. She sees beyond that. She sees the manly look, the chiseled look, the way he acts and carries himself. It's all of that stuff, you know, that kind of that bad boy atmosphere. And that she's struck by that. She's really taken back. She's, wow, this might be the guy that I want to be around.
So they started going out. Now, did they move in together at that time, or were they just kind of seeing each other? Oh, by the way, I did read that after their first date, he sent her a dozen long-stemmed red roses.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, he was just
that Ike Turner move.
Right. Putting out the bait.
Yeah.
And, you know, at that particular time, he was already on the search for somebody. Mm-hmm. He needed somebody. But of course, he was already starting to get into a lot of other things, early fantasies. But he was actually searching for somebody that he would more or less would become an accomplice. It just wasn't a girlfriend he was looking for. It was somebody that he could count on and use to, you know, put his fantasies into reality.
And he saw that in Charlene.
He saw that he could dominate her, and that she was, you know, quiet and a nice girl, and he could dominate her, and she did everything he wanted. So it was a perfect setup.
She just didn't know it.
She didn't know what she'd bought into.
Yeah. So one of the things that came out of his early marriages was a daughter named Krista. And Krista was born in 64. I remember that because that's how old I was. And that's when I was born. And he celebrated his birthday in 1978. This was after he and Charlene were together. And she had a duplex. I don't know where that duplex was, though.
It was in Carmichael.
It was in
Carmichael. It was just off Eastern Avenue.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Well, that
I gotta go find that.
I think it was a single family dwelling.
Okay.
What I think it was. Okay. Now, it could have been you'd call a duplex sitting on the corner.
Okay.
You know, would be a single family dwelling. But yeah.
It was one of those.
Yeah,
like one faces one. Okay,
right.
I got it. Carmichael's chock full of those.
Yeah.
Okay, so she was there, and then so to celebrate, this is what a sick, sick man he was. To celebrate his, you know, and by the way, if people are triggered by certain words or certain, you know, images of abuse, et cetera, you probably really should not listen to this episode, because we're about now to start wandering into an area where some things are going to be said. And honestly, if you are triggered, I really recommend you don't listen to this, because I've worked in the DA's office. I've seen a ton of stuff, and even I had a hard time reading about some of these things.
And I can say the same. I mean, I remember this case. I remember that after looking into everything about it. And it's just shocking, even for mm-hmm. me, you know, working yeah. over 300 murders, yes. all these cases yes. that I've handled. And this particular murder, this particular individual goes far beyond
yeah.
others that I'd ever come in contact
with. You know what gets me, John, is people talk about, oh, Charlie Manson. Charlie Manson, a fucking Boy Scout. He ain't never killed right. anybody.
No.
You need to be afraid of people like Gerald Gallego. That's who you need to be afraid right. of. People like him. Because that guy is a sick buck. He really is. Charlie Manson holds nothing, right?
No.
Zodiac killer, nothing.
No.
This is the kind of people you should tell your kids to watch out for. This kind of guy.
What makes him so dangerous is that he can turn on the charm, and he did. To Charlene. He could turn on the charm to different people, like her parents.
Yeah.
You know, everybody that he needed, he knew how much charm to turn on.
Yeah.
And then when he turned it off, then he became the other person.
Yeah.
And he was pure evil.
Pure evil.
Pure evil. Pure Nothing evil. Like any of these other individuals.
No.
And what makes him scary is this is a guy that can stand next to you, work for you, date your daughter, or be your friend or whatever, and you would never know anything about it.
No.
What's
Until it's
going
too
on.
Late. Until it's too late.
And when it was too late, yeah. there was no turning back and there was no getting out of the situation. None.
So I'm talking about what happens here, because what happens next on his birthday in 1978 is really, really important, because it plays a large role into what happened after this. And that is that on his birthday in 1978, his daughter was there with them. Charlene was home. And for his birthday present to himself, he not just raped his daughter, but, you know, we can bleep this. I don't know, bleep this out, but he sodomized her. And while Charlene was there, and right. Charlene allowed it all to happen, probably watching TV, at least from what I've heard, she was in the living room.
Another room.
Yeah, I right. heard it all. And it was just, you know, hey, it's just Gerald being Gerald. And I think that was a triggering point for his daughter, who apparently he had been abusing. He hadn't gone that far with her, but he had been sexually assaulting her since she was 6 years old.
Correct.
She was just a plaything for him. But that was the point at which I believe she said, that's too much. I have to do something about this. And so I think the mother was up in Butte. Was
Butte County.
Butte County.
Right.
And she went up there to Butte County, and she finally told the authorities. She told the cops that, right? Am I?
Right.
That
she'd made the report.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so they put out a warrant. For Gerald Gallego, for oral copulation, sodomy, unlawful intercourse, incest, the whole menu of sick stuff, and so he went back up there and found out about it, right?
Right.
And so what happened?
He basically takes off. You know, he knows there's a warrant out for his arrest, mm-hmm. and he would use that warrant situation in a couple of different ways with Charlene. You know, if somebody was looking for him, and she also. They would also tell the parents. So the whole thing was, yeah, there's a warrant for me if anybody's looking for me, that kind of a thing. And but it was there. It was out of Butte County, the okay. warrant.
So all of his crimes actually were committed while he was on the run.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
Which is amazing. All of his crimes were committed while the guy had an active warrant out for him on the run, a parolee, and he was still, did not slow him down a bit.
No.
Didn't slow him down a bit.
No.
Fact, he upped his game. And so at that point, he's talking to Charlene and he tells Charlene, hey, you know what? We need to take our relationship to a different level.
Right.
And what happens? How did this all occur?
Well, he starts telling her about all these fantasies. And she's
Happened. Well, John, something happened before that. And that is that he had come home and he found her in bed with a woman, yeah. A young woman.
Right.
I think she was 16, 17. I'm not sure. I see differing reports. And he found her. I think she was a dancer or a stripper.
Well, it was someone. It was one of his.
He had brought home.
Right. He'd been with this
yes,
woman.
That's right.
Yeah. So, in fact, they had a threesome. And he leaves, comes back, and he finds her in bed with the dancer. So he's just ballistic about the whole thing.
That's right. He goes crazy.
Yes.
And I believe the reason he goes crazy is because he wasn't in control.
More than likely.
She had her own agency. She was making her own decisions. I'm going to follow up on this.
Right.
And the other reason I think this is important, because it goes along with what I've read about her previous marriages, where she kept wanting to invite women into that relationship.
Right.
So there was something there. And I don't say that to be salacious. I say that because I believe it's evidence for future actions and whether you believe what she says or not. So the man she was having the affair with, right? You need to bring your wife into this. One of her husbands said that she kept saying, hey, let's go find a woman. Let's get a prostitute, and bring her home and all things like that. And so now he comes home. She's in bed
right.
with this 16 or 17 year old stripper he brought home.
Right.
And she's, doing her thing.
Yeah,
and he goes crazy.
And you can't help but think, with her, when did this all start? This, wanting to be with having women involved. And so I kind of look back at high school when she first starts, dabbling into these sexual stuff. And it might have been there. I don't know. But it would be curious to find out when was the first time she was ever involved with another woman. And was it in high school? Is this one of the things that she was involved in? And why the other girls kind of called her out on it.
Yeah.
Calling her,
called her slut,
called her various names. And then slowly her personality on campus kind of went downhill.
Right.
So I don't know if it happened there, but it continued. And that particular incident, he was really upset.
And I think he used it as leverage to say, hey, now here's how you can make it up.
Right.
Right. And so how did he break this to her that this was the new life that they wanted to move
on? Well, like you said, he wanted to up the game. He says, hey, here's what I want you to do. And at first, after he explains, I want to do this, and how he basically talks about all these fantasies, these young girls with tight bodies and buttocks and all of this stuff. And he's telling her this, and so she's kind of like, I'm not really sure if this is what's going on,
And they got a van, and it's kind of funny because we all now, we talk about, a serial killer van. That's actually what they had.
Yeah.
Who's what you picture as a serial killer van. And I don't know if they created the trope. They certainly didn't hurt it.
Right.
Because they traveled the Western United States in a literal serial killer van.
Right.
With a mattress in the back.
Yeah.
And it had a little nature scene painted on the side.
And those were popular in the 70s. They were really popular in the 70s. You could buy these vans and have all these nature pictures or mountains or whatever you wanted. Mm-hmm. And they had it.
They had
it. And on inside, you'd have the big, either fur or, but they had a bed.
Get the captain's chair.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, you had it all. But those were really popular.
They were popular. If you're listening to this now and you're young, you're probably going, oh, that's crazy. No, it was very, very popular. And people would customize their big Chevy vans.
Right.
I'm sure the other companies made them too. The reason I want to also clarify, the reason we were talking about her sexuality, again, is nothing wrong with that. But the reason we're bringing it up is because I think it goes to her veracity when we're talking about those future crimes and her role in those crimes and whether she was in fact an actor in those crimes or a bystander in those crimes.
Right.
I think it's important. I think many people might disagree with me, but I think that it played a role or not that it played a role. But I think we should look at that when we're thinking about her actions in those crimes and whether she was just an innocent bystander or an actor. It reminds me of the Homolka case up in Canada.
Right.
This is what it really reminds me of.
Right.
In many ways. And we can talk about that later. But
yeah,
I do want to talk about the Homolka case.
Yeah. Homolka case, very similar, with her husband.
Right.
And what happens on the first time that the incident takes place with the killing of her sister.
Right. Her sister.
Yeah. It's mind-boggling when you think about it.
And then after they make the deal, they find the videotapes where they find out, no, she wasn't innocent.
Right.
She was actually directing the shit.
Right.
So we move now. They've got the serial killer van. Again, don't know if they invented it. Didn't hurt it. If they were, this case could easily be called the mall killers. It really could.
Right.
Because a lot of their stuff was done at these malls, which at that time in the late 70s and 80s, they were at their peak. Everything, especially in Sacramento, they hit three of the big malls in Sacramento, Arden Fair Mall, Sunrise Mall, and Country Club.
They were all popular, right?
All popular.
All popular at the time. All new to everybody. Indoor malls. That was the thing.
That was the thing.
You know? And these particular, and one of them still is popular. That's Arden right. Fair Mall.
Arden Fair Mall still there.
You know?
Carousel's not, but
no,
it's there.
No, Carousel's gone. And yeah. Country Club Plaza Mall, it's not there anymore. It's divided up.
Yeah. Now it's like, yeah, right. It's
and different. Sunrise Mall is still out there.
Sunrise Mall is still hanging on.
Still out there.
So in September of 1978, they decide, I think actually, ironically enough, it was September 11th, 1978, they decide to go out to Country Club Mall. And this is where he's going to let Charlene prove herself to him.
Right.
And he asks her to lure a couple of young women for him, for his needs. Now he's saying, what I find interesting, John, and maybe you can comment on this or maybe not. He keeps talking about he wants sexual slaves. That's what he keeps talking about, Gerald. We need some sex slaves. We need sex slaves, right? And he talks about it that plainly, by the way. We need sex slaves. But the fact is, he never did. He had them and killed them almost immediately.
I think it was just part of that fantasy, having these sex slaves do everything that I want you do. But then I think after it was done, he had no more use for them.
And he just
killed them.
He couldn't help himself.
No.
He just killed them.
And, and then, you know, it would go away maybe. And then the fantasy started up again.
Yeah.
Whatever triggered it.
Yeah.
It would boom. Here it's triggered. And now I got to do it again.
So in September 11th, 1978, there were two young women who were at the Country Club Mall. And their names were Rhonda Scheffler and I think Kippy Vaught.
Kippy Vaught, right.
And he had Charlene, right? His I don't think they were married at this time, his girlfriend. Well, are they married? No, I think they got married after. I think they first got married in September 30th of
They got married twice.
Yes. The first time was right after this, by the way. And there might be a reason. And so he has her go to the mall and lure him a couple of nubile young victims. He wanted them young. Right. And she did. And again, hearkening back to the 70s, she lures them with, hey, you want to smoke some pot?
Right.
Right. And then what happens there?
Well, she brings them out. And of course, when they come out, and then they're basically, I think what's happening out there is Gerald's waiting and confronts them, probably with a handgun, and loads them up into the van. And off they go. Mm-hmm. But with these two girls, they were the oldest of the mall girls would pick up. They were both 17.
In fact, Scheffler was married.
Yeah. That's both 17. One was visiting the other. Mm-hmm. And when they decided to go to Country Club Mall. Mm-hmm. And after being taken out by, and you know, and at that particular time, Charlene looked just as innocent as anyone. You know, again, she was like almost looked like them as far as age wise. You know, young. Mm-hmm. You know, like, hey, come on, let's go smoke.
She was the perfect lure.
Oh, she was perfect.
Small, cute, petite.
Yeah,
right.
Nobody would ever suspect her.
2 weeks after that, September 27th, that's when the charges are filed against him and are drawn up against him in Butte County on September 27th.
Okay.
And so now it's official. Now they have a warrant out for him. 3 days later, that's when September 30th, he tells Charlene, hey, let's get married. Let's go.
Right.
Let's get married. You know, and so they and they fled the state.
Right.
They fled the state.
Got out of the state. Got out of everything.
And do you know where they went?
I'm not quite sure where they probably took off, but I don't know where they took off after the wedding, after they were married.
I think
they went off somewhere.
Yeah, they went off to Houston for a bit, I think. And he was a bartender.
Honeymoon.
Yeah. Doing his bartender thing, because he was a bartender.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you remember where?
Bob Les Club.
It's still there.
On Del Paso Boulevard, right here in Sacramento.
Still there.
Yep. That's still there.
The Bob little Les place. Club.
Yeah.
And that'll come in handy a little later during the trial. Then for a year, they were quiet. I think for about a year. And then in June 24th, 1979, they're up in Reno and there's a county fair. And what happens then?
Yeah, what goes on? It's the Washoe County Fair right in Reno. And they go hunting again. He wants two more girls. So he puts her out to find them. And eventually they bring this 14-year-old and 13-year-old girl. Young teens. Those are the two that would be his next victims.
You know what's interesting on that one is she didn't use the marijuana. What she did was she told him, hey, do you guys want to earn some easy money? I don't know if you know what handbills are. People listening,
it's like passing out handbills.
Yeah. It's like, hey, you want to earn some easy money? You just put these on the windshields of cars.
Right.
That's
fair
all
was going on, and that would be something. That's something that you would see somebody while they had all this stuff. People's, you know, this captive audience, they would put all these handbills out.
And this was Charlene who was doing this.
Right.
This was Charlene. So you know what I mean? This was the innocent woman.
Right. She's orchestrated this.
Yes.
It wasn't. She was told. She orchestrated how this would work.
And so she tells them, come on back to the van where I have all the handbills, right? And they go back to the van, and there's Gerald to intercept them with the gun.
Right.
Puts them in the van.
Right.
And, you know, he does what he does.
Yep.
And their bodies weren't found for, God, 15, 16 years later, right?
Their bodies were found, I think it was 1999. And it was because a property owner up in Lassen County, he was going through his property and he found the remains. So almost 20 years later, the remains were found. 20 years.
Yeah.
So they had gone from Nevada and they just went right over the line, and they were in Lassen County at that particular time where they got rid of the bodies.
So they're quiet a little bit for a little bit. And then around April, I think it was April 24th, 1980. So now we're up into 80. And but when I say they're quiet, believe me, they're not quiet, because
no, we have no idea what they've been doing.
That's right. These are just the ones that Charlene told us about.
Right.
That's all.
Right.
These are the ones that she told us about. We have no idea how many more victims, how many more bodies are out there, how many he did without her being involved.
Right.
We don't know how many she did, but maybe she was so shameful that she doesn't even want to admit those. She thought, oh, this is enough.
Right. Because you got to remember, he would leave on times. He would disappear and then he'd come back. And she wasn't about to ask him, you know, what are you doing? And on one occasion, he came back and he had a little bit of extra money. And she was kind of wondering, you know, I wonder where all that came from. Well, you know, he was probably out pulling robberies, doing all kinds of stuff. So it wasn't that I think he just stopped dead. Whatever he was doing, we have no idea.
We have no idea. And so April 24th, 1980. Sunrise Mall in Citrus Heights. Man, there's so much shit that happens in Citrus Heights. I swear to God, every killer we've talked about has been somehow related to Citrus Heights.
Yeah.
Man. Unbelievable. But they're at the Sunrise Mall. I wonder if they bumped into the Golden State Killer. He's there, hey, how you guys doing? Good. How are you?
Yeah.
Have a good day. So anyway, April 24th at the Sunrise Mall, and there's two young women, both 17.
Both 17.
And they're leaving a bookstore. At the Sunrise Mall. Sunrise Mall back then, and I can tell you, 1980, I was, you know, in the 10th grade. I would come out here sometimes, and that was popping. That mall was popping.
Really popular.
That was all a very new area there at the end of Sunrise Mall. I mean, at the end of Sunrise Boulevard, for those here who don't know Sacramento. It was a newer area there, a lot of development. It was so popular, there was a mall there, and then if you go across the street, there was another mall called Birdcage Walk.
Right.
It was very, very popular. So these two 17-year-olds decide to go to the bookstore. I don't know, B. Dalton, whatever bookstores they had back then. And then they're leaving, and Charlene was sent there. In fact, what I've read is that Charlene was sent there. Gerald got so upset that it was taking her too long that he went in there and poked her and said, what are you doing? You know, you're letting me down. And she like was looking around like, dude, we're in the middle of a mall. what I mean? Easy, chill. And, you know, but he, like, as we said in the beginning, once that train started rolling with this guy, there was no.
He didn't care.
He did not care.
He wanted to go in there and force the issue. Hurry up, get him, get out. I need this.
Yes, that's right.
I mean, that's how he was, this like, animal.
Yeah.
I need this.
In fact,
he needed these girls.
Many of his ex-wives and ex, you know, girlfriends described him as an animal in many ways. But they're like, he was just animalistic.
Yeah.
So they did. And she lured them with the marijuana lure again. Right. Hey, you guys want to go smoke some pot? You know, we got a van out. This sounds so 70s, I swear to God. You know, we got a van out in the parking lot of the mall, you know, and they go out and he did his thing. He was there again with the gun in the back, and you know, and he took them. And I don't know, do you know where they were taken to in the end?
They found the remains from the girls. They found their remains up just outside Baxter? a Lovelock.
Okay. So old Nevada tramping grounds.
Right.
I think on those, I remember he actually bludgeoned those to death. It was like
hammer
with a hammer. These poor young 17-year-olds. This guy, this is the guy that people should talk about when they say, be careful, or Gerald Gallego is going to get you.
Right.
Not freaking Charlie Manson, not the goddamn Zodiac killer.
Yeah.
This devil, I swear to God, this is the hardest case to research. So they found them. They were gone. And that was in April. And in May, Charlene got pregnant for the second time.
Right.
So she'd been pregnant before. She decided not to go through with it. But this time she decides to keep it.
Right.
Right. Now, remember, the whole time, there's an active warrant out for this guy.
Yeah.
Right. There's an active warrant. But he's going by a different name.
They even get married twice. The second time they use different name. He uses a different name. Stephen Feel.
That's right.
That was one of his aliases. So that's a name he went by, Stephen Feel.
That's right. He becomes Stephen Feel.
Yeah.
In order to get away from that active warrant.
And there
warrant.
Is a real Stephen Feel.
He's a cop, right?
He was a cop, and they even contacted him same day to birth, everything. So you have to kind of think, where did Gerald get all this information? He got it somewhere.
They were married in, for the second time, they went to Reno, and they got married as Stephen Feel.
Right.
They made this official. He is Stephen Feel.
And I think Stephen and Charlene Feel.
And he needed to do that so that he could get the cops, right?
Right.
Off of his. I wonder if he chose the cop's name because he thought that would be helpful. I don't know.
What are your thoughts? It might have even been by chance.
Yeah.
We'll never know.
Then one of the saddest. So June 1st, as anybody would do after they get married, they decide to go to Oregon, to the coast of Oregon. They were going to go with another couple. But the couple decided not to go with them because he got physical with the wife or with the girlfriend, with the female of the other couple that they were supposed to go to Oregon with.
Right.
They dropped out because he got physical with her. I think he, I don't think it was sexual. I think he was abusive.
Right. He blew his lid.
Yeah.
And again, once he started to turn, that was all it took. And then he became this evil monster person with this bitterness or this being so mean. But yeah, it was just totally different.
And so
they didn't want to, they weren't going to go.
Yeah, they weren't going to go.
They was like, no, thanks.
So this is one of the hardest ones. To me, this is the hard. And actually, Charlene Gallego, in my opinion, the monster that she is, she actually says that this was the hardest. This was the one that she had the most sympathy for, if that's possible, right? But there was a young woman named, a 21-year-old named Linda Aguilar. And she lived, I think, in Port Orford or Gold Beach.
It was down by Gold Beach where I think it occurred. But okay. I think Port Orford is the organization and the police department that I think it was that's where she lived.
So she was going to Gold Beach for a doctor's appointment because she was, I think, 4 months pregnant.
Yeah, she was pregnant.
And she was hitchhiking. And, from everything I've seen, she was very, very attractive, 21-year-old, pregnant, 4 months pregnant. I mean, God, that's a postcard, right? I mean,
right.
people write poems about that shit. And but that's not what Gerald sees. No. Gerald doesn't see, oh, how beautiful, a nice, pretty pregnant lady walking. Oh, hi. No, he doesn't see that. He sees a meal.
Right.
And he decides that he needs her. He has to have her.
Right.
They'd just been married a week ago. They had just been married for the second time.
Right.
They're out on vacation, I guess. And apparently I heard that they had just the most horrific relationship. That it was either arguing, long periods of silence, killing. It was a horrible relationship. It was one of those, which I guess you would expect between two people like this, right? And so I guess the trip out there had been horrible in the van. And he sees her and he decides that, he has to act. And do you remember, what happened?
I think part of it was, as far as she was concerned, he was getting back into it again. He was set off again. I think now the fantasy started to take over again. And so he was, I think, searching. She just thought they were on maybe a nice vacation. But I think after that kind of blew off, I think he just particularly wanted to find somebody up in Oregon while they were up there. And when the opportunity came about with this Linda Aguilar, he decided to put it into play.
So it was pretty horrific because he picked her up. He got into the back seat and then she pretty much knew what was up from the beginning.
Right.
And what I think is horrific about this case, about this specific one that he did. But let me be clear. They're all horrific. This is, as I said, the most. This was horrible. And I feel bad for like my poor young poor young woman that helps me on this stuff because she has to listen to this. And I know it's not easy because this is honestly the devil's work.
Yeah, these are heinous crimes.
These are heinous people.
That people don't want to talk about.
We want to forget.
That's what all you want to do. You want to forget about them, but we can't forget about that they did occur.
We can't. They're and out
that,
there.
You know, if you don't understand history, then like mm-hmm. some say, you're doomed to repeat it. And the last thing we ever need is someone like this.
Correct.
Back in our community or anywhere doing this of what Gerald was doing.
So he sees her. They pick her up hitchhiking. And, you know, she knows what's up. And I think this was one where he was pretty clear. He just got down, did his thing, you know, did what he did. Beat her with a rock and then strangled her.
Strangled her with some, I think it was fishing line.
Fishing line. And yeah. then buried her.
Yeah.
But the horrible part is they found later when they discovered her body is that she actually had been buried alive.
Right.
Because they found the sand and
with
the dirt.
With the autopsy, they could see that uh-huh. there was probably she wasn't dead when he put her in the ground.
Right. They found sand and dirt in her lungs.
Yeah. Terrible. Just horrible.
Just a horrific death. And that was in you know, that was in Orford. And then they decided to come back. And so they come back to Sacramento, and then on 17th of July, 1980, it's a bar yeah. they had been to a couple times, the Sail Inn. It was there about 5 years ago in West Sac. It's like an old dive bar in West Sacramento. I don't know if it's still there or not.
Oh, yeah. I have friends that live not too far from there.
yeah.
It's still there.
It is.
Still popular
yeah,
bar.
It is.
The Sail Inn.
And they still have the same parking lot last time right. I drove by there when I was in West Sac, all gravel.
Yep. Not much has changed.
So they were there that night with a number of other people in the bar. And there was an attractive bartender by the name of Virginia Mokel. Mm-hmm. I think that's Mokel?
Mogul.
Okay. And 34-year-old with a couple kids.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
She was a mother, just working, trying to
make
do
a
her
living.
Thing. Trying
yeah.
to do her thing. She had served them a couple times, which is interesting because this is the first time they had actually killed someone that they had actually had interactions with before.
Right.
All the rest had been just complete strangers. You know, Charlene had lured them and boom.
Right.
But this one, they had actually talked to her. She had served them. But he decided Gerald had to act.
And this is one where she was looking at him, Charlene, as like, what are you doing? We've interacted. These people mm-hmm. know who we are.
That's
and
right.
she couldn't believe that he was doing this.
There were many people in the bar that
right.
night. They had all seen them in the bar.
Right. In the bar and the vehicle and everything. And, this is when she starts questioning.
Correct.
My gosh, what's wrong with you? You know, look at people are all around, and then you want this gal? Because he tells her specifically, yeah, I want her.
And this is when I, in the beginning, referred to, you know, she was, you know, one of her descriptors is high IQ, and one of my descriptors for him is just stupid. He might have been smart in many ways, you know, and how he maybe got along on the streets, maybe not, because he was in jail a hell of a lot for someone
right.
who might have known his way
always
around.
Always got caught, yeah.
He always got caught.
Yeah.
But this is when he started just doing stupid stuff, right? So he was in a bar with a ton of people in there, and apparently, according to the cops, they were very boisterous.
Right.
He and Charlene, they were loud, so they would be noticed.
Yeah.
And their car was in the parking lot.
Yes.
And so he goes to the window and then, you know, has his gun and he captures her. And
yeah, she comes out. You know, and
it's 2 o'clock in the morning. She just wants to go right. home.
He walks up to her car and he shows the gun, gets her out. And the next thing, here she is at the van. And they put her in there.
And in this one, she says, why don't you just kill me?
Right.
Yeah. Why don't you just kill me? And he did this is one that he did with his bare hands.
Right. Strangled her.
Strangled her to death.
Strangled her to death.
And then they dumped her in the river. She was found in Slough House. Clarksburg.
Clarksburg down by Freeport in that area there. They found her just along the river.
Yeah. And that was in July of 1980. So you can see he's starting to act because before there had always been, at least of the ones we know about, there had been like longer breaks. But now it's like June, July. And then now we come. But here is something else, John. And that is that the cops actually, this is the first time they had visibility with the cops.
Right.
So what happened there?
Well, not on specifically this one here. Oh, yeah. They had, someone had gotten I think it was a license number or on the vehicle. And made contact with her. West Sacramento made contact with her.
Yeah, with Charlene.
Charlene. And said, hey, you know, what was going on? And she just, oh, yeah, this and that. Mm-hmm. Oh, no, we left. Well, who are you with? And everything was, you know, I was so drunk. You know, here she is. Now, mind you, she's pregnant. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I was so drunk, I don't remember. And
it was the 70s.
Yeah. You know, and it was like, you know, she wouldn't give any good answers, but it was enough for them to think, well, you know.
Yeah.
But her thing was, I had so much booze, I don't know what happened, but I had no, you
correct.
Know,
that's right.
I don't know anything about that.
I was so drunk.
I played it off and they kind of like, yeah. Okay.
But what's important about this is that she was put into their name, Stephen Field. And her, they were put into the record of
The system.
Yeah. They were at this place when this happened. And so now they're in the system. Right. Now they're in the system.
Which isn't that big, because remember back then, 70s and 80s, the technology then was very limited.
So it was
it was like a file or a fiche. Because I want the audience to understand, we never had the technology. You know, we didn't have cell phones. Sure. No cell phones. We didn't have that type of technology. I mean, if you had a pager, you were a big man on campus.
Yeah.
So that was one of the things, you know, that made it more difficult, is everything was done by hand. Mm-hmm. All searches were basically done by hand. And you had to look at reports and look at cards. We used to make out cards when we stopped people at the department, and we'd fill these cards out and they'd be filed in a card box, file. Mm-hmm. And you'd have to actually go in and look for them. And that would tell you, oh, this person was stopped on this day. There was nothing to enter into, no computer, no anything. Mm-hmm. So that is one of the reasons it just made it very, very difficult to try to cross-reference or find these things.
Right. That's right. Which, and I think we might have talked about this before, which is why I think that this was such an age of people who did these types of crimes, because technology had not caught up to their level of evil yet.
Right.
It's a lot harder to do this now. Right.
Because, oh, absolutely.
You know, there's a camera everywhere. You know, you got things pinging here, pinging
social
there.
Media. I
yeah,
mean,
right.
If these things were going on, you take your phone, you'd be, somebody was talking to you the way they had talked to other people. They'd be, videoing it.
Right.
So, oh, yeah. Today, you have to be very cunning. Not that it can't be done.
Yeah. It probably is being done while we speak.
And it can be. People are more cautious. They just know how to work it.
Yeah. Yeah. And I know I talk about this. This is like what I think is one of my my great ideas, which is it took a period of time for technology to catch up to evil. And I think in the late 80s, it probably started getting there, right? The early 90s, we started getting
86 DNA. Mm-hmm. So that was another thing. I mean, no DNA. I mean, how do you, you know, find the evidence taken off these bodies to determine who the suspect was? Not then. No DNA. Nothing.
Nothing.
Not until 86. And then from that point on, technology started to grow a little bit.
Now, even when I was in a district attorney's office in 95, 94, it was still tough. I would still have to like go through files, right?
Right.
Big drawers that you'd pull out.
Yeah, hand files.
Yeah, it was still tough. So that was Virginia Mokel, right?
Virginia
Now they're in the system. Now they're in the system. So if something else happens, now there's something to cross-reference, right? But they still can't get them up in Butte County.
Because they don't have the information.
Yeah. They don't have the information, and he's got a different name now.
Right.
And so what happens next is that within in July. So 3 months later. So he's like, you know, hey, I need to be fed. I think he said that literally to Charlene. And so they decide to go, and they go out and they have drinks at the bar. They're at the bar. And the bar was close to Arden Fair Mall. And again, as we talked about at the beginning, Arden Fair Mall was a popular mall then. It was all new area. It was all growing. Sac State, which is the big college in Sacramento, is right down the way, right down the road. And a lot of the students from Sac State would go.
Oh, yeah. It was a very popular place. And remember, Gerald only lived several blocks away.
Where did he live?
He lived just off of 80, off of Howe Avenue, right there, Bluebird Lane.
Oh, my God. That's where he lived?
Right there.
Bluebird Lane. Oh my God, that's such a ratchet place.
That's just north of the Arden Fair Center.
He so looks like he would live there.
Yeah.
I love that piece. That's good.
Yeah.
Bluebird Lane. So, Gerald, you know, I always wonder if people, like, because, you know, someone lives in a place where, like, you know, Ted Kaczynski lived.
Yeah.
Someone lives in, you know, the Batgirl killer's apartment.
Yeah.
And they don't know. The one I always drive by is the Sacramento vampire killer, Richard Trenton Chase, who lived in an apartment that faces Madison Avenue right across from the Del Paso Country Club. Those apartments are still there. That apartment is still there. And I always wonder, God damn, do those people know?
Yeah.
Like, what kind of
that's
shit
this
went
individual,
down
yeah.
in
what
that apartment?
Over there?
Yeah. No, I guess not.
Nope.
No.
No, time just, you know, they say just time you know, sheds a cover or spreads a little dust or smoke. So people, and then again, people sometimes don't want to know.
So it was November 1980. They're having a drink at the bar, and the sorority and fraternity guys from Sac State are having what they call Founders Day at the Carousel. And the Carousel was a popular place.
Very popular.
It was really popular.
Yeah.
I remember driving by it.
Yeah. I think I think I went in on one occasion just to see what it was like in there. Yeah. Really nice. I mean, it was a nice place.
Yeah.
Young people hang out, that kind of thing, you know.
Yeah.
But I was at the mall and I wanted to see what it looked like because everybody was, we hang out at the Carousel.
Yeah.
We go to the Carousel. I wasn't a person to hang out at bars.
And I was too young. But I remember driving by it and I remember, the Carousel is kind of where the food court is now and stuff. But it was a big deal. I had a big name out there. Anybody who grew up in Sacramento in that era would know about the Carousel. Again, a shopping mall. Mm-hmm. And this is late. I think it's like after midnight or 1 a.m. or it's late.
Yes.
Right. They've just come from having a beautiful night with all of their friends, Craig Miller and Mary Elizabeth Sowers. And they're coming out of the Carousel talking to each other. And he's like, I want them.
Right.
I want them. Now, this is the one that makes me think that Charlene played a much bigger role in this than she leads us to believe. Because there's a lot of shit that went on before they drove away with that couple. And you want to talk about how that happened?
Well, in fact, I think Charlene was thinking, oh my gosh, you know, now we're doing this. Here are these, they're much older. You know, they're 21 and 22. Bigger.
Bigger.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a big
Craig,
guy.
Big guy.
Yeah.
You know, Gerald, no. Short guy. And so it was a whole different circumstances. And I think Charlene now is thinking, you know, wow, do you really want to do this? But I mean, he was primed for this. This is what he wanted to do. Yeah, he made Charlene get those two, you know?
That's right.
So there she got out and she worked her magic.
She worked her magic and they got into the car. And then one of Craig's fraternity brothers comes out. And he sees them sitting in the back of this car with a man in the driver's in the passenger seat, that he doesn't recognize. And he knows that that's not their car.
Right.
And he's like, you know, what's up? And so he goes around to the car. Now, I've read conflicting things about what happened at that point. What do you understand happened at
that
point?
Well, my understanding is that he goes over there and he basically leans into the car. You know, and it kind of jokingly that, you know, they're all in a good spirit. You know, they had a wonderful evening and he kind of like, hey, what's up? What are you guys doing? You know, but one of the things that he later talks about is he's looking at them and he's looking at their faces and they're this kind of, you know, this expressionless. And he's like, hey, what's going on? You know, but before and he sees Gerald is in the car. And they're not saying anything. They're just kind of looking and he just thinks he's just taking like, this is a little weird from my friends. Mm-hmm. But again, while he's there, guess who comes up?
Charlene.
And basically whacks him.
She slaps him in the face.
Yeah. Tells him, what the heck are you doing over here? What, get out of the car. You know? So now she's making the move to throw this guy out, which she could have said, hey, look. And then, you know, it could have ended there.
Right.
In my opinion.
Or she could have said, thank God you're here.
Yeah.
You need to rescue me from this hell.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
No, let your, or to say, hey, let him out. We don't need, you guys go on. We're going to go do our own thing. They could have squashed it. No. She told the individual, Andy, get out.
Yeah.
After she slapped him.
Slapped him. And he's like, what the hell? Right?
Right.
But it was so weird and it was so obvious something was happening. If I remember Craig's quote to him was, Andy, this is not a place where you want to be.
Right. That's what he tells him.
Yep. This is not a place where you want to be.
That was the last thing he said to him.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, so he really, you know, getting slapped and everything, but he had enough about him that he thought, I'm going to copy the license plate number.
That's right.
And he copies the license plate number down and they're not using the van. They're in the Oldsmobile. They're in her car. They're in her car, the car that her parents bought her. So they're using no more in the van. Yeah. They're using another car.
They had sold the van.
They got
rid of the van, sold it to a couple in Orangevale.
Right.
But again, showing a sign of his stupidity, they left actually bloody sheets in there.
Right. Because the car, it was found later on.
Yeah.
And the people who bought it said, hey, you know what? Here's what we found in here.
Right.
You know, they left everything in there.
Yes.
It was almost like it was starting to unravel.
It was starting to unravel.
And I think Charlene, with this situation at Arden Fair, mm-hmm. I think she started to see something is really going wrong here. Yeah. He's becoming careless.
Mm-hmm.
He's becoming more aggressive. I mean, it's like a stag in rut.
Yeah.
You know, I got to have this. Mm-hmm. I need this. You know, this burning fantasies that he's trying to accomplish. You know, he starts in his head and then he's got to have them. Then he acts them out. And that I think she starts to see this whole thing started to unravel.
So here's what happens. And this is, again, to my side against Charlene. They go back to the apartment. He takes Mary Elizabeth to the apartment.
Right.
And Charlene's there.
Right.
And she's there sitting in the other room while he... And I'm not going to go into it, but what he does, what a monster like Gerald Gallego does. So they take Craig up 50, up to El Dorado County.
80.
Oh, 80. Oh, no, him
no,
50.
No, they're on 50, right.
Yeah, because, and here's why I know this, because it's created a huge problem in the case with jurisdiction. Because they had so many different counties involved. They had Yolo County, Sacramento County, Placer County, El Dorado County. Nevada,
right.
It was like everywhere. So they took him up to Bass Lake and shot him three times.
Right. They're on Highway 50. Uh-huh. If you drive up today, Highway 50, you'll see it. Bass Lake Road.
That's right.
And back in those days, it was desolate.
That's
there
right.
wasn't much out there. I mean, you go up there now and there's homes all over the
That's
place.
That's where I live.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I you live don't 4 miles. That today.
Yeah.
That was Bass Lake Road. You did have residents up there because one of the residents up there would say they thought they heard three shots in the early morning hours.
That's right.
But they drove up there and that's where they made Craig get out and walk in front of the vehicle. But they had him take his shoes off.
Yeah. Why was that? I read that.
Gerald basically told him, okay, give me your shoes. That way, when we leave you here, it's going to be hard because it was all gravel road.
Yeah.
And so it's going to be painful for you to walk, but it'll take you time to get back to the road.
Okay. So he won't fight.
Right. That's what he's telling him, to get out of the car. So I think at that point, Craig thinks, okay, maybe I have a chance. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure. He gets out and starts walking. And then Gerald gets out and then walks up behind him and shoots him in the back of the head.
Three times.
Correct.
Three times. And that's Bass Lake Road. And as John mentioned, I actually live there now. I live in what's called a place called Serrano. But then that was all. In fact, he was discovered by hunters. That shows you what kind of country that was then.
Right. A couple of young guys.
Yeah.
Out there.
Bass Lake Road was a very small road. And you had deer out there.
Yeah. And it wasn't like they hit him.
Yeah.
He was basically kind of in the open.
Just left him right out
there. Right on side of the road.
Yeah.
Just boom. Right
and
there.
Some of the people who live, I wonder, some of them might still live there now up on the hill, but in some of those old homes that I see up there, but they heard gunshots. They reported that.
Told police that they believe they heard up to three shots in the morning hours.
So then Charlene drives them back.
Right.
Back to Sacramento.
Right.
To back the apartment.
Back to the apartment.
Where Gerald takes Mary.
Right.
Takes her into the bedroom while Charlene sits outside by herself, no gun to her head.
Yeah.
Nope. And he does, you know, the horrific things that Gerald Gallego does.
Right.
And then they drive her up to Placer off of, I think it was off of Sierra College Boulevard.
It was right near, now it's Sierra College Boulevard, and then you have Sierra College right there. And that area was just all farmland.
That was all farmland.
All farmland. And that's where they took her out to one of the off-roads. And put her out. I think it was in a ravine. Mm-hmm. I saw the pictures and they actually had found her remains. So she'd been out there long enough that you could tell that was a period of time that had gone by. And they left her there. And it was again, a couple of young guys out hunting out in the area that found her in there. And she was still wearing the clothing that she wore that night. She was still in the clothing. And I remember looking at the picture and it was just so mind-boggling for me. You know, they just basically had her, it looks like they had her sit in this little hole or a concave area. They had her sit there and then he fired the shots into the top of her head. And it just struck me of how evil must you be mm-hmm. to do something like that?
And she was honestly, and I know the term's used a lot, but if you read up about her, she was the all-American girl.
Yes, all-American really girl, had a great life ahead of her, great career, you know, just now budding. I mean, yeah. it was all there, had everything mm-hmm. in life to live for. Yeah. I mean, it was just great incredible. Family. And Craig also, you know, I mean, and again, yeah. they were just one of those all-American couples.
So, you know, I always wonder if like one of the reasons Gerald wanted them is because he saw them and that's something he never could have had.
Right? Or achieved.
Right. That would never be his life. And he hated them for having that life.
Yeah. Because
he was going to show them.
Yeah. And it seemed, you know, when you look at it, you look at his other victims, we're all talking teenagers, easy to manipulate, you know, easy to control. And that's what it made it easy for him. Now you got adults, mm-hmm. grown people, and Craig could have fought him. But maybe it was that. Maybe he wanted to exert upon him, hey, you know what? You may think you're something, but here I am. Mm-hmm. You know, now I've got the gun. Get in. You'll do as I say. Yeah you never know. You never know what was going through his mind.
Yeah.
He was that creepy.
He was. So now they go back out there. I think what I read is they go back out there to hide the body, and they realize, oh, shit. The body's gone. There's a lot of footprints. There's cigarette butts. They're about 70s.
Right.
And so they're like, oh, God, this is coming down again. But again, that's how he started decompensating. Right.
Right.
Like he couldn't cover his tracks anymore. He was just acting like an animal. You know what I mean? No thought behind right. the crimes anymore.
It was whatever was going on. It was totally unraveling.
Right.
It was like he didn't really care. He was so comfortable with himself. He thought he'd never get caught. You know, hey, look at me. I can do all these things. I'm not even getting caught. Look what I've done so far. And this is one of the things with male serial killers. Eventually, you know, between women and men serial killers get caught more frequently than women. Because what happens is they just get more unraveled as it goes along mm-hmm. and get worse and start doing things and eventually get caught. Where female serial killers, they can go a long period of time. And because of their gender, mm-hmm. because of how they do things, they're never looked at in any suspicious way. So they're allowed to carry on.
Right.
And he is a great, you know, example of somebody that starts to come unraveled after so many killings.
It's coming unraveled. And you know, there's good examples of that. Dorothy Puente, no one ever suspected her.
No.
No one ever suspected her. She's, you know, even though she wasn't, she was a freaking grifter. But anyway, but to the public who see her on the street, you know, they're like, Abuelita. And she wasn't Mexican either, by the way.
That's right.
So but they're like, Abuelita. And she just gets caught for stupid reasons out of her control.
Right.
Same with Comiskey, right?
Comiskey, same thing.
Same thing. She could have kept going, but a stupid thing got her caught out of her control, right?
Right.
But you're right. The male serial killers, it's that testosterone starts getting in there or whatever it is.
Ted
you know?
Bundy, you know, he's on the run, right? He escapes when they captured him from one agency and what does he do? He goes to Florida and he goes down there and kills some co-eds.
Yeah. Maybe his biggest killings ever.
It's not like I'm trying to get out of the country. I'm going to get to Canada. I'm going to flee somewhere. No, I think, hey, I'm going to go down and kill some more people. They're just totally unraveled.
I always say there are two kinds of people in the world. There are two people. There's two kinds of people in the world. And here is how I define them. There's a person who, if they get someone shoots at them and they miss, they go, whoo, I'm not going to get in that position again.
Right.
And there's the other person who, if they get shot at and the person misses, they go, hey, I'm bulletproof. And I think the men tend to fall in that second category, right? Instead of going, hey, I'm not going to get in that position again.
Right.
Ted Bundy, I think, was a good example of that.
Totally.
So this is where you kind of come into the case, right? Now you're working. Right. So the cops now, they're in the system. They're like, the guy had taken the license plate down, right?
Right.
And they're looking at that case in the CLN. And they're like, hold it a second. There was a Charlene Gallego, right? Or in a Stephen Field that were at that sale in when that crime happened.
Yeah. The YOLO detective starts putting things together. It starts to unravel because, and this is what, now he starts to look at what he's doing and how he's going to correct it, mm-hmm. you know, leaving Craig Miller up there in the open.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, now he's found. Craig is found by the two boys up there. But they have Andy, their friend, copied that license plate number down. Craig and Mary don't show up in the morning. So now the police are contacted and a report is generated. They get talk with everybody involved. They get the license number and start looking who it was done. Now the police, now the detectives, Detective Burchette, Detective Taylor, now they start going out and contacting Charlene's parents. because the vehicle that he copied belonged to her. So they go to her house and they start saying, hey, where's your daughter? She's not here. She's with her boyfriend. They don't say husband. She's with her boyfriend. Oh, you know, this and that. We don't know. They said they were going here. And anyway, now it starts to. Well, in the meantime, she calls while the detectives are there. And I'm sure she's like, oh, my goodness, I knew this was going to happen. So she tells her parents and she tells the detectives, yeah, I can get there. Yeah, I'll be there. Well, she never shows up, you know, never shows up. And that's when it now starts to go up. Gerald panics. He wants to get her and they want to go back up to Bass Lake Road. Mm-hmm. And they want to get whatever evidence they can get from that scene to kind of protect them. But what they don't know is Craig's already been found. Mm-hmm. So that whole thing is starting to unravel and it starts getting worse and it gets bigger. And now the ball is getting bigger and bigger. You know, more things are coming forward. All these outside agencies, these different jurisdictions start seeing this particular case. And now they're looking at their kidnap, mm-hmm. murder and rapes. And now they're all getting together saying, yeah. wait a minute, we have similarities here.
Yeah, Oregon is saying, yep, hey, everyone. We had someone who was strangled with nautical wire. Hold
Washoe
a second.
County, everybody. Yeah. Now everyone's saying, wait a minute, we've right. got the same kind of it's thing going on in. Here. Yeah, mm-hmm. it's all coming together.
So what do they do? What do they do?
Charlene and Gerald?
Yeah.
Well, at that particular point, they do have an opportunity and meet with her. And she's talking to Detective Burchette. And I think, and Detective Taylor, and she gives, and her parents are there, and she gives some bogus, you know, and now at that time, Gerald's her husband. Mm-hmm. Okay. We were out, we went to a show, we went to the Village. Remember the Village?
Oh, yeah. Movie theater?
On Fulton Avenue,
yeah,
you know?
That's
and,
right.
She said, yeah, we went out there.
It's like old tiki style.
Yeah.
Or
what
something.
Car did you take? Because now they have the license number and they have an eyewitness.
Mm-hmm.
And, so she says, oh, yeah, well, we took his red little car, you know.
The Triumph.
And he's not there. Mm-hmm. But the detectives see the car outside and they're like, wait a minute. So then they start pressuring her a little bit. And she starts saying, you know what? I'm sick. I'm pregnant. I don't feel good. You know, let me think about it. You know, when I sober up, she's like 7 months pregnant. When I get better, I can talk about it and we can, you know, start doing stuff. So they're still cautiously looking at things, mm-hmm. you know, but one other witness that really becomes a key part. There was another witness who had seen Charlene and Gerald in the vehicle. This couple was, and this particular individual was outside in Arden Fair when Gerald and Charlene drove by and looked at he and his girlfriend, just staring at him. And I'm thinking, was he picking? You know what?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we'll get them.
He was hunting.
That's right. And the witness says he just dead stared him. He just looking at him like sizing him or whatever. But it was that stare like, you know, here's the predator.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the prey. And because he did that, this witness was able to remember his face. He says, I can't tell on the female.
Yeah.
But he says, I definitely was looking eye to eye with the male. And he describes Charlene, you know, little mousy hair, kind of tiny.
I remember that.
And he would be able to pick when the detectives take photographs over of Gerald in a lineup. He picks him right out and says, that's the guy that was in the mall. That's the guy that was in the car.
Yeah.
That's the guy that looked at me like, you know, he wanted to kill me. You know, he was just one of those looks. The guy described, he just looked dead at him.
Yeah.
You know, and I think at that time they were probably saying, is this the couple that we want?
Yeah.
But it wasn't. So, and the couple kept walking, but he never forgot his face.
So they go and they're on the run, right?
Right.
Here's what I'm confused about. Did Charlene's parents help them? Because I'm kind of torn because it sounds like they helped them, but then they also called and let them know that they were sending them money or I don't.
The way I read it and understand it is that they weren't all that cooperative. I mean, they there was a lot of things they probably could have mentioned. Mm-hmm. They never mentioned the fact that instead of Gerald being her boyfriend, they were married.
Yeah.
And they eventually tell detectives, hey, they're married. I think what happens is they realize something has happened. You know, hey, the boyfriend's picked out. Your daughter, it's her vehicle. You know, all the answers. she's now gone. They're on the run. They've taken off. And now I think the Williams become very cooperative. But you remember, I mean, it's like, it would probably be like parents.
Yeah.
You know, you want to protect your child.
But at a certain point, you're like, okay.
You know, and at a certain point when you realize, you know, the child that we love, the child that we reared, that had every opportunity for a good life, is now in deep trouble.
So there was a piece of evidence that came out, the bullet casings, right? The bullets.
Right.
When did that happen? When did they find out that those were the bullets that matched the bullets that killed Craig Miller?
Okay. We had found out that he worked at the Bob Les Club on Del Paso Boulevard. He was a bartender there for a short time. You know, I mean, he worked as a bartender in other places.
Yeah.
But he kept getting fired.
He got fired all the time.
He'd work in a card room. He got fired. So you have to remember, what was the guy doing that he got fired? You know, I mean, it's like he couldn't hold a job. He couldn't do anything. Yeah. People just didn't. You know what it was? People didn't like him.
Yeah.
Overall.
Well, they liked him at first.
At first.
Yeah.
But then he started getting weird. And they just said, you know what? Gone.
Yeah.
And so he's in this bar. It's late. It's early. You know, they're going to at closing time. And there's an intoxicated, inebriated individual there that won't get up, won't go out. So what does he do? He takes his 25 caliber Beretta. And he just unloads shots into the ceilings of the bar. And, you know, oh, everybody's just stunned. Mm-hmm. And, of course, he gets together with one of the other bartenders there who would become another key witness. And she talks with him about it. And he says, hey, look, you know, this is what was happening. I apologize. Don't tell the owner. I'll get up. So she watches him. Mm-hmm. Get up and patch these holes up in the ceiling.
But leaving the bullets in.
Yeah, he doesn't wonder where the bullets went. He probably thinks they went outside.
Into space.
Yeah, somewhere, you know. And so he's patching this up with the stuff. Well, anyway, that information was received by Detective Burchette. And I believe we had gone out one time, and that's when the information we gleaned that information, went out, talked to one bartender, and he says, this is the person you need to talk to. She would know everything, and she knows about the incident. And so there was nothing then. But then Gene went back and with the witness and a couple of people from the bar there, he climbed up into the attic and he found those slugs.
Oh.
He found those slugs. Miracle. He found those slugs. I mean, when he knew there was holes up there, it's easy to kind of evaluate if there's holes, there's got to be something up there. He got up in that small crawl
place. Gene.
Yeah, he did. I mean, the guy had just, you know, he was going to solve this case. And, you know, he got up there. He climbed up there himself and got in there and he took the slugs and he got him. And then after he got him, then he booked him into the evidence and they were going to be sent out to the lab.
And so that's what really tied them, right? They knew then at that point, we got our gun. We know that's his gun. We got our killers.
With the forensics, the lab finds that the slugs in the ceiling at the Bob Les Club, they match slugs that were found in the body of Craig Miller.
That's right.
And that was the bingo.
That was the bingo.
Also, the slugs they found in Miss Sowers, they were so deteriorated that they were unable to. However, in both cases, in Bass Lake Road, they left the casings. This was a semi-automatic.
Yeah.
He leaves the casings.
Oh, my God.
With Mary Sowers, where he kills her, he leaves the casings. So they were able to take those casings, and with the casings, they could see where the pin marks and all the forensics used in identifying these casings. And they were able to show that both the murders were committed by the gun, by him.
And then, so now the noose is really, right?
Oh, yeah.
Just really closing in. And so they decide we're out of here. So now they've absconded, kind of like everybody in our stories do.
Right.
They hit the road. And they have asked the Williams, right? The Williams, right. Charlene's family.
Right.
To wire them money.
Right. They have them wire a couple of times.
Okay.
A couple of times they get a wire. Hey, we got, you know, we're doing this and doing that. And the Williams are kind of like, hey, you know, the cops, you know, I think they're telling me, you know what, the cops and everything. But my understanding is not all that mm-hmm. cooperative at that particular point.
Okay.
There was some resistance. You know, I mean, Charlene's father just thought she walked on water. I mean, this is the type of relationship they had. You know, he took her everywhere in his business outings, everything, bought her the car, did all of that. You know, I mean, he shed all of this on his only daughter. And so, of course, you're going to be resistant when people are telling you this is what they're involved in. You're going, get out of here.
Yeah.
That's not what my daughter's involved in. And so there's some resistance. But, you know, as time goes, they see what's going on. As more evidence unfolds, more of these crimes are starting to be publicized. They're starting to see, oh, my gosh.
And so now they're the feds are after them, right?
Get the FBI's involved.
FBI's involved. These guys are crossing state lines.
Right. They need a UFAP warrant. So you contact the FBI and we think they've crossed state line. We need a UFAP warrant. Mm-hmm. So a warrant can be used anywhere where they find them. And now the big chase is on.
Yeah.
Where are they? That's what everyone wants to know. Where are they?
Yeah. In Sacramento, of course, was all because this was a big deal here and it's on the news all the time. I remember that. But it's funny because you only knew about one. You didn't know the depth of depravity that they had done at
you
that point.
You knew about Craig Miller and Mary Sowers. But as far as everything else, they were just trying to connect that.
Yeah.
And that would come later when they finally, in the end, talk about here's all they've done. And I think it just, I think people just couldn't believe the level of their horrific crimes, their spree.
So on November 1st, they had killed the Miller and Sauer. And November 26th, the FBI get them in Omaha, Nebraska.
November 17th.
November 17th. Yeah. Okay. So it happened quick.
Right.
It happened pretty quick.
Right.
And they were caught in Omaha, Nebraska, trying to get money at a Western Union that the Williams were wiring them. And FBI.
Right. What had happened is she called home, said, hey, Mom, Dad, I need some cash. We'll maybe work. I'm sure she said, we'll work this out or, you know, we're going to come back or, but we need money. So I think the Williams say, okay, we're going to wire you some money, go to the Western Union there, and they tell them where they are. And then that family contacts the FBI and says, our daughter called, here's where they're going to be. They think they're getting a pickup of money. And so the FBI and everybody from every jurisdiction is there. And when they come to get the money, boom, that's it. No resistance, nothing. He just, hey, here I am.
Yeah.
They just take him.
Oh, that guy had been in jail so many times.
That's he was probably thinking, oh, I'll get out of this.
Yeah.
You know.
So they take him to Sacramento?
Yeah, they bring him back.
Because I know there's a big jurisdictional fight because, again, their crimes had been, well, they didn't know all of them at that point.
Right.
But they did know Placer, El Dorado, and Sacramento, and Yolo.
Right.
So they take him to Sacramento. And is this when you met him or?
Yeah, he was here in Sacramento County Jail when we brought him over one time. And again, like I will never forget. I will never forget seeing him being next to him. I mean, I was sitting right next to him in a small interview room, in a small holding room. And he was chained up. But you know, he was just unreal. He never said a word. He just, you know, why am I over here? You know, and I'm sure Gene was hoping that, you know, something would be said about anything. And to no avail, he wasn't going to do anything. But we weren't there that long, and I took him back. But I remember me being next to him, me being around him, made me physically ill. It made me physically ill. It was like this aura that he had around him was so evil. I remember coming back to the Hall of Justice, and I felt sick.
That's amazing.
And
it's not surprising.
And I think I told that to someone else when I'd gone home. I think before that I said, you know, I said, I felt this pressure. It was like somebody was like a pressure on me. It was strange. I'd never experienced that, and never did after that at any time.
In any other case?
No, and I've been around all kinds of people, Moore, Solomon, Puente, everybody. Mm-hmm. Never.
God.
But he was just that evil of a person.
Evil.
And you know, of course, some people say, you know, people have these vibes.
Yeah.
People have this aura. People have this extra energy that they cast. So I don't know a lot about that, but I'll tell you, I know what I felt. And it made me ill. It made me ill. I mean, he was pure evil.
You can't help but think he knew that he had that effect on people.
I think he knew that he had that much in power, mm-hmm. or whatever it was. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like Charles Manson. When you look at him, mm-hmm. here's another guy with small stature, yeah. same thing. But when you looked at him and people, it just, ooh.
Yeah.
Even his followers.
Yeah.
Bigger, you know, could have over. No, they just, whoa.
Yeah.
You know, his whole thing, mm-hmm. you know, it's remarkable.
Yeah. So John, one of the most interesting parts of the trial I found was that Gerald Gallegos, as they entered, as they entered the defense portion of the trial, decided that he wanted to be his own attorney. I think as most sociopaths do, they believe that they're the smartest people in the room and that they, you know, can have their way with everybody because they just don't know as much as them. And so as a true sociopath, Gerald Gallegos decided he's going to be his own attorney. And I think more importantly, he knew that the key witness for the prosecution was his former wife, was his spouse, right? Charlene Gallego, because she is the one that had flipped on him, at least for the things that she admitted to. Lord knows how many other crimes are out there that she didn't talk about or that she didn't know about. So Charlene, his spouse, was the lead witness for the prosecution. Gerald was now going to be his own defendant. And in court, the first thing he tried to do was say, aha, spousal privilege. We're married. You cannot compel one spouse to testify against the other, which is true law. And so he tried to invoke the spousal privilege because if he could knock out Charlene, they really couldn't get him on a lot of other stuff, right? And he knew that was the deal because by acting as his own attorney, he had knowledge of all of the deals that had been cut. So he knew she was the key. So an intrepid investigator for the Sacramento, I think it was Sacramento County DA, but let me just say the DA's office. Might have been Sacramento, might have been Yellow. There were so many counties involved. But Frank Dale, who was an investigator for the district attorney, I think it was Sacramento because he was working for the prosecuting county. So Frank Dale went to the former wives that he could find. And he was able to find the second wife. Remember, he had been married 7 times, twice to the same person, right? Charlene was number 6 and number 7. So he found wife number 2. And wife number 2 said, what? Gerald Gallego? He never divorced me. We're still married. Pulled out the wedding certificate. Frank Dale went to the court, didn't find any divorce that had ever been filed. Ergo, Gerald Gallego could not invoke the spousal privilege against Charlene because they were never legally married because he was still married to the second wife. Therefore, not only was he not married to Charlene, he was a bigamist. So they could have got him on charges of bigamy also. So Charlene was able to come forward and to testify against Gerald. And all of the cases that she brought forward, right, the 10 murders were alleged and proven, and he was given the death penalty. I have always found that was incredibly amazing and that more people don't talk about that because that was a damn good investigator for the DA's office. So they're here. They're going to go to trial, right? She cuts a deal, right? But she held out for a while, right? Or no? She didn't hold out?
Nope.
No? What happened?
All this time, she doesn't say diddly, won't cooperate, diddly, nothing. Nothing. Until, and this is what a lot of people don't know, Gerald was writing letters to Charlene at jail. You can communicate that way, right? You send post letters and they get them. Because at the old county jail, you had the women's facility, the male facility, it was all in one building. But he could mail letters out. So on one particular occasion, he just happened to be mailing letters to his girlfriend.
Oh.
And by some strange means, the letter to his girlfriend ended up going to Charlene, and the letter to Charlene ended up going to the girlfriend. The mail somehow ended up in different hands. And Charlene read the letter that he wrote to this girlfriend. And that was it.
That was it.
What you never see. You never read.
You never hear about that.
And yeah. That's the straw that broke the camel's back. After everything she endured, everything that she decided, I am not going to give Gerald up. I am not going to say anything, because she actually thought she was the pinnacle of all women. That she was it. She was the top girl. And as long as that was that way, she was fine.
By the way, just to, not to interrupt your emotion there, but that was a big deal with them. His number one, his number two.
Right.
He ranked them.
Right. And she
wanted to be number one.
Number one.
Yes.
Do what you want to do, but I'm number one.
Yeah.
Well, whatever was in that letter, and I can't imagine with his fantasies, his sexual fantasies, mm-hmm. and what he was talking about, that he was describing something or saying something. She read this. And that's what did it.
And that's why Charlene Gallego turned on Gerald.
Yeah. The next thing, boom.
That fast.
I want to make a deal. And then, of course, that that causes all the agencies now. Mm-hmm. She wants to make a deal. So the way she has to do now, they've got to corroborate all these deaths. So she's going with agencies all the time. They're taking her to Washoe County. They're taking her to all these different places where Slough House, mm-hmm. where the two girls were killed at Slough House, and all these areas. So she's able to corroborate all those murders he did, all 10 of them. Some of them are tough as far as evidentiary information, but she can go to all the sites. Now, the two girls from the fair, mm-hmm. they're the ones that they didn't find.
Right.
For years.
Yeah, 20
years.
That
was because she couldn't pinpoint where it was. And I mean, they were out of Reno. They went all the way up Highway 395, and then they actually cut across California, and they were in Lassen County, and that's where they got rid of them. Those are the only two, but it was the owners of the property that found their remains, mm-hmm. almost, 20 years later.
Yeah.
But yeah, she gave all the information, and then she got on the stand, and she would testify against him. And she talked a lot about, some of the things. And at this particular point, this is when she decided that, she was a victim of all this. She was a victim.
When that started coming out.
Right. She was a mm-hmm. victim. He made me do it. I was, I thought he was going to kill me, because he could have. Mm-hmm. But when I look at him and I think, yeah, he could have killed her. But there was too many people that knew they were together. I mean, they were married. I mean, that would lead right to him.
Right.
So I think, well, I don't think he would have killed her. But she said, he could have killed me at any time, but he never did, because she was such a good lure.
Right. Right.
She was really good as bait.
Yeah.
Perfect. And just toss her out there, bring back a couple of people. And I don't, in my opinion, I don't think he would have ever killed her.
See, I don't either, because I think if he would have killed her, he would have to kill a whole bunch of other people. And he wasn't that type of killer.
Right.
Right. He was a sadist. He was he acted on his emotions, his animalistic stuff. Right.
Right. Exactly.
He wasn't a guy who's going to go out and kill 12 people who's all seen them together. And, right. He's not going to do that.
No. And with her, I think also is that I can't help but think, even given everything that he did to her. And he did a lot to her sexually, mm-hmm. that she testified to in open court.
Right. Yeah, right.
Some of the stuff that he did to her was just unimaginable, but she talked about it. Mm-hmm. And even though she didn't care for it, mm-hmm. she did it. She went along with him because she wanted to always make him happy.
And she wanted to be the number one girl.
You don't need to go anywhere. You don't need to have other people. Mm-hmm. I'm your number one. I will do this for you. Mm-hmm. But again, she said, I'm a victim. In fact, I know here... several years back, she did an interview mm-hmm. with a local station. And in the interview, she ended up saying that, a lot of people, there were a lot of victims killed by Gerald. She just happened to be one that lived. And I thought to myself, how terrible to say that, to say that you're no different than the victims that he butchered, mm-hmm. that he raped, kidnapped, shot, or bludgeoned, or beat with a hammer to death, and you're putting yourself in that position as mm-hmm. of one of them. Right. And I thought the audacity of that is just unbelievable.
Yeah, I mean, he tortured them in ways that I won't even talk about on this show, because I just can't, because those are thoughts that stay with you. It was really hard. And I read the court cases, and those are very hard to read, because as court cases go into every gory detail.
Right.
And this.
And she did. She covered it all.
Yeah.
And, it was It was her. They had to make a deal with her. They had to make a deal with her.
But did, okay, so to cut to the, not to cut to the chase, but to finish this up, she ended up, he was found guilty. Yes. And he got the death penalty. And that's what the prosecutor wanted, right? The prosecutor right. wanted the death penalty. And that was what he was driving for. And he got it.
Right.
And in order to do that, she cut a deal, gave her 16 years. I think 16 years, 8 months.
Yeah. Was that she it? Did 16 years, 8 months. I think it was a 17 year sentence.
Okay.
She did 16, eight.
And she was released in, God.
1997.
She's been living amongst us for 24 years.
Yes.
Charlene Gallego.
Yeah.
Who and was there.
It was surprising that she surfaced. And of course, you know, I would imagine she's living under a different name, but she is still in the Sacramento area. Mm-hmm. She actually, allowed to be interviewed as long as mm-hmm. they kept her identity.
Yeah. I saw the interview. They had a black face or yeah, that
blacked
shadow.
Her out and, yeah. and she went along with it. And of course, that's when, you know, she basically puts herself as, mm-hmm. as a, she was just a victim. Mm-hmm. But you have to look at everything in the totality. And when you look at everything and you read everything, then there's a big question mark on that.
Yeah. And, you know, that's why I talked about her, you know, her proclivity for, you know, sex with women in the beginning. Not to be salacious or not to cast judgment on anybody
right.
who does that. But you wonder what parts of the story she left out.
Right.
What parts of the story she left out. And when she's giving the prosecutors this evidence, they're going to give her every benefit of the doubt. They're not going to dig in on shit because right. then she'll shut up.
They're not going to challenge her on it.
They're not going to challenge her.
You're giving into the defense.
That's right.
And so they had to go with it. They listened to her. She laid it out. They cut her the deal, you know.
Yeah.
And I can't imagine if the letters would have never been switched. How would they, you know, where would the prosecution have been then?
Were they switched on purpose? I also wonder if some guard was like, hey.
I don't know.
Or you won't answer.
You know, yeah. I mean, you know, I don't know.
So, yeah. So, I mean, it's the classic question. It's the one that happened up in Canada with Carla Homolka.
Yes.
Who, again, probably some of the most horrendous crimes that I don't, if you already know about them, you know about them, but I don't think anyone should research them because what they did to their own sister, her own sister, and the prosecutors cut a deal with her, sweetheart deal, like a real, like 8 years or something yeah. like that for these killings on behalf of her husband. She played the same thing that Charlene did. Oh, I was abused. This is all part of it. After the deal is cut and they can't go back, they find a box of VHS tapes. Up in the attic, and the prosecutors get the VHS tapes and they go, well, hey, let's look at these. And they're tapes of Carla essentially directing the action that takes place with these poor young victims.
Right.
But there's nothing they can freaking
nothing.
Do about
no,
it.
No, they cut the deal already.
They cut the deal. Yeah. So Carla Homolka is walking amongst the people of Canada. And if you Google her name, you'll see that people are keeping track of her. She ended up marrying the brother of one of her defense attorneys. But this kind of reminds me of that. It's like, did yeah. you have to cut that deal? I know she did like twice as much as Carla Homolka. But you know what? Her crimes are like five times as worse because there were so many victims.
Right.
And they were so young. And they were so innocent.
Well, they had, on the Craig Miller and Mary Sowers case, they had them dead to right. They had them dead to right. But they had all these other cases.
But did they need to cut a deal for Craig and Carla and
you know,
Mary?
I don't know. I don't know. I just know that they wanted to bring in all those other cases.
Okay.
And they were able to, using Sacramento as the jurisdictional agency, and that's why the case was tried here.
Okay.
Well, actually, it wasn't tried here. They moved to Martinez, California, because of all the publicity.
Yeah, yeah.
So they moved it, you know, what, 80 miles down the road, like it was going to make any difference. But they moved it down there, and of course, he's found guilty.
Yeah, so he was found guilty, got the death penalty. But what's ironic is that after doing all this, so they got the death, so they could get the death penalty, he ends up dying of cancer, like not that much longer, right? After
well,
his.
Yeah. Interesting. He's after he's sentenced, all done, he's taken to San Quentin. Well, after this case, now Washoe County, they want to prosecute him. The state of Nevada wants to prosecute him on murder charges, death case. So what they do is they get an extradition warrant. And it's to get him out of San Quentin death row and bring him up and put him on trial in Nevada. So what now is happening at San Quentin is the state is trying to prevent the extradition of him. They want to keep him there. Now you got to remember also, Rose Byrd is in the Supreme Court right now.
For California.
And the death penalty is basically zilch.
Yes.
So, but they're trying to keep him on death row because they know Nevada has a death penalty. However, they're able to serve the extradition warrant. And the detectives, Lieutenant Ray Biondi, who did a masterful job.
He's a legend.
On this case. Yeah, he was a legend.
Yeah.
God bless him.
Mm-hmm.
He did so much work. He and Stan Reed, both another guy that I looked up to, a homicide detective sergeant. And, you know, they did such a great job putting all of these cases because the majority of them were in their jurisdiction. And he really put a good job together. And, you know, I give him so much credit, he and Stan Reed. And so what happens at Folsom, I mean, Folsom is San Quentin is they all go down there. And what they're going to do is they're going to serve the extradition warrant and they're going to actually transport him back. They're not going to wait for any bus or anything like that. They actually go down. There's a little bit of paper shuffling and a little bit of, I don't know, this. However, no dice. They get it. The appeals court rejects any stopping it. And they're able to physically take him, put him in a car, and they head right up to Carson, Nevada, right up to the state capitol. And there he's incarcerated. He's put on trial. He's found guilty for the deaths of the two girls. And he sat on their death row, never to come back. And I remember that even the prosecutor in that case, he vowed, and I remember this specifically, he would say, Gerald Gallegos, it will never go back to sit in the death row in California. He'll be executed in the state of Nevada. I remember that.
Yeah. By the way, that was a huge deal in California at the time politically. Yeah. Rose Byrd, the Rose Byrd court, who essentially refused to allow any executions at that time. So that was what was behind that.
Yeah.
Well, I guess Gerald ended up just like his daddy, right?
Right. Put on death row, just awaiting execution. And for him, he got developed cancer, and that's what he passed away from cancer in the year 2002.
Yeah.
And actually, he passed away one day after his 56th birthday. He celebrated his 56th birthday, and the next day he was dead. But I can't help but thinking, and you know, I know a lot of people think, well, you know, it's just too bad they didn't execute him and do all of that. But, you know, that's for the courts to say and their system. But what I always think about is this. I think more terrifying is here's this animal that's sitting in death row in Nevada. 24 hours a day, you're locked up. You're given an hour, you know, basically 23. You're given an hour to get out. He has to sit there and languish in his own fantasies. He has to sit there and think about what he would want to do, what he could have done. Everything about that, he has to languish in that every day. That's the type of person he was. He didn't stop thinking about these fantasies.
Right. It was a train.
That's right.
That was just constantly revving, but couldn't go anywhere.
No. He was in four walls. Yeah. And I think, you know what?
That's a good hell for him.
That is, he was in a living hell.
Yeah.
A living hell where he had to think about that every day.
So was he a bad seed or was he shaped that way by his environment?
You know, some people want to say he's a bad seed, but then you got to look, he's got a son.
Yeah.
Gerald has a son. Gerald and Charlene has a son. I'm not sure where he is or what he does or where he is this point of his life. But I would hope that he was taken. Of course, he was taken away from her after birth. But I would, you know, it would be interesting to know where he is in this point of his life or if he even knows about it. But I think with Gerald, I think his life, his father was mean. It was just a terrible person. I just think that his upbringing shaped that way of life. You know, his mother being a prostitute, men coming in, all this carrying on in front of him.
In front of him, right.
You know, and he's a young child and he's just seeing all this over and over and over. The brutality toward women would make me think about looking at his mother, you know, the hatefulness. You're a prostitute or you're this. And you know, that's why he smacked his wives. He beat them. You know, he even threatened one with a hammer, or he might have beat her with a hammer. But it was incredible. Yeah, this thing. So it's hard to say. You know, you don't want to say, hey, it's all bad seed and, you know, it's going to be that way. And I would hope that the young man is living a good and productive life and is nowhere near or have any idea of what really took place. What his biological father was really made of.
And I guess my last question for you is, Charlene, do you think she was a willing participant, or do you think that she was against her will?
You know, it's hard to say. You know, when women get into that, it's like a woman being in a domestic violence relationship. Mm-hmm. When I was in that unit briefly, you know, the woman would be beaten to hell. And then she'd come in, I want him arrested. I want him sent away. Look what he did to me. And then when they understand the seriousness of what could happen to him, go to prison, mm-hmm. go to jail for a long time and all that, they were back in saying, you know, it's my fault. I did it. If it wasn't for me, he wouldn't have done this, you know. And so that victimization. But I think it's only because it was something that they revered, like Charlene revered Gerald in that way, that, you know, she might say, you know, I was a victim, or, you know, I blame myself or something like that. I don't know. It's hard to say. I don't personally look at her like a victim. I think when you look at the circumstances, and you look at everything she participated in, anytime she could have walked away.
Yeah. And there were long breaks.
Yeah.
There were long, long breaks right. where she wasn't with him.
Right.
Right.
Right. And, yeah. She was gone. She left.
She could have left.
No. And then she went
to the cops.
Went right back into it.
Yeah.
So you think, well, what was it? You know, this magnetism. Mm-hmm. It's this whole power he had over her.
Yeah.
And so it's not like, well, she could have gone to the cops. Now, remember, she didn't tell him where Mary Beth was.
That's right.
She wouldn't tell where the body was. She wouldn't. And so it's not like, okay, now we're all done. I'm going to show you. No. In the very beginning, you say, hey, the hell with you guys. She wouldn't say a word.
Yeah.
And she was, I know Detective Burchette told me that she was terrible. She called him everything, all kinds of names. You know, you can't accuse me. And it just went on and berated him. But what he did tell me was, after the letters were found to have been mistakenly mm-hmm. exchanged, the next time he saw her, she came to him when the whole thing was going to take place of going out and show where everything happened. And he said that she couldn't apologize enough.
Wow.
Of her behavior and the way she spoke to him and everything she had said to him. He said she had apologized for all of that. So, but that was then. I mean, you know, you're saying, yeah. Well, that was then and this is now. You know, two different sets of circumstances.
Yeah. And she's somebody's neighbor now.
Somewhere
in Sacramento. And we do know she lives in the Sacramento area.
Yes.
We know that for sure.
We know that for sure.
We know that she's living under another name.
Yes.
And we don't know what it is. I've heard different names, and I'm not going to ask you to tell me because I don't think you can.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
But she's somebody's neighbor, and yes. She's shopping next to somebody. She's standing in line next to somebody at the supermarket. And who knows? Maybe she switches.
Well, I do know from the interview that she'd had that she does a lot of charity work. Now, this is something that maybe out of all of this, she decided to try to make some mm-hmm. sense out of her life and do something good. And she does a lot of charity work for veterans associations.
Okay.
So, you know, but in my own mind, as far as what happened, my view, it'll never change. No matter how much you do here, it's not going to change what happened there Mm-mm. ever Mm-mm. in my mind, in my thinking. You know, this is all good. Mm-hmm. This is all good. And I guess the final judgment will come someday for her when the ultimate judgment will be made.
Yeah.
On her, you know, what part she played in the whole thing. It's not for me to judge, but it'll come from a higher judge, I'm sure, someday. Mm-hmm.
Well, John, I want to thank you so much once again for, you know, being our guest. This was a long one,
yes.
But it deserved to be a long one. This, as I said in the beginning, is one of the hardest cases I've ever had to like bone up on.
Right.
And it was not easy. And so these crimes, and we kept so much away from the listening public.
Right.
In our discussion. But, you know, when you're doing the research, you actually have to
right.
read it.
Right. And I just once again want to thank and acknowledge the work that the detectives did. I mean, communities should be so thankful that they have the type of people that were on these cases, and given with no technology.
Yeah, no technology.
They went out and walked it on foot, went door to door. And Detective Burchette, Lieutenant Ray Biondi, Stan Reed, you know, Placer County, a detective sergeant up there. All of them that were involved did such great work and able to bring this whole thing together. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I credit them with being able to do this. But, you know, I'm thankful. I'm thankful we had detectives like that. And it was, for me, a privilege to work around detectives like that, because these were the ultimate detectives, you know, and I pride myself, and that's the way I conducted my work. You know, I like to think that I did the best that I could for the community, and I did everything possible to help families and to solve these murders. So, I want to thank them for all their work, and hard work it was.
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks, John.
Thank you.
Till we meet again.